Hi there guys, welcome to the Divine Truth Experience YouTube channel. My name's Nicky, and as you can see, my usual partner in crime, Perry, is not with me. Instead, we've got my cousin Peter, who's here with us today. He's making his debut on the channel. And it's basically what we're going to do today is we're going to just talk about the effects of suppressing emotion through physical addictions and what happens to our lives when we do that. So we're going to talk, I'm going to ask Pete a couple of questions about his life, what happened with him with regards to that topic area, and just to give an idea to everyone at home, you know, what can happen when you're choosing to avoid your own emotions within you that you're suppressing through taking these actions to do so. So first, Pete, why don't you introduce yourself to everyone at home? So obviously, I know you extremely well. Obviously, we've been cousins and whatnot. So go ahead, bro.
Sure. So first of all, hi everybody. As Nicky said, my name's Peter. First things first, a couple of basic things. I was born in Derby, the same city as Nicky. You know, we grew up together. I'm 25 years old, 26 in a couple of days' time, though. I've grown up always, you know, enjoying sports. I never had a religious background. Just did the very typical things that you would expect of a young lad growing up in the UK, really. Nothing too extravagant, nothing too outside of the norm, really, you know, really typical stuff. And didn't really have any particular religious experiences or thoughts about God. I was really just a young lad, more interested in having fun and enjoying myself and doing that. So I did that for a good number of years. You know, I ended up going to university at 18 years old. I went to Manchester University to study business management. Had a good time there. Didn't learn all too much from my course, to be honest, but I learned a lot of valuable life experiences. Mm. And then after that, I moved down. I had a brief little stint in Singapore and Thailand, actually, for about 2 months, but then moved down to London, where I began living with Nicky again quite shortly after moving down anyway. And it was there in London, I guess, that things started to slowly turn for me for a number of reasons that I'm sure we'll get into later on. And eventually ended up finding Divine Truth in 2013. And never really looked back ever since, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the first question I'll ask you, bro, is like, what happened when you, like, how did you first come across Divine Truth? What experience did you start coming across? And, you know, what feelings did you have at the time? If you just like to give people at home just an idea.
Sure. So it didn't come from a curiosity to actually want to know, or certainly not at a conscious level. It didn't come out of a curiosity to want to know the truth about God and the universe. Basically, at the time, I was very, very enwrapped in a romantic pursuit. There was a relationship that, like an on and off, long distance relationship that I was forever in and out of at the time, that had ran over a good number of years. And basically what happened with it was that towards around 2013, building into the summer, I really sort of lost my patience with it in terms of, I was keeping in a lot of my own feelings about how I really felt, like how strongly I really felt about this person. And I was trying to kind of play it cool, you know? And this had gone on for a number of years, you know, like I said, from 2011 straight through till summer 2013. And I actually knew the person a while before that as well. I met the girl perhaps when I was 16 years old. So there was history before that, but it was real intense from 2011 onwards. And coming into summer 2013, I felt like I was at a crossroads in my life, because I'd left London at this point in time and had moved back home, as you know.
Yeah.
A lot of my reasons for doing that were to try and allow myself more freedoms, because I was working a classic like 9-to-5 down in London. And like I said, this was a long distance relationship. And I mean, long distance as in across the other side of a big ocean.
Yeah.
You know, not the other side of England.
Yeah, it was pretty intense, that was, wasn't it?
Yeah. So basically, I felt like I wasn't particularly content in my job anyway. I'd worked it for 1 year in total, and it was kind of what I suppose I was supposed to do with my degree, you know.
Yeah, it was quite boring, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Because
we
both worked in the same place, you see, and so it was pretty boring.
Pretty boring. Nothing truly exciting about it. I wasn't passionate about it at all. It was just following what they tell you is the norm and the right path for you with this degree and such and such. So, you know, I had growing dissatisfaction with that, growing frustration about the long distance relationship, and felt like I needed to work something out that would be able to solve both of them issues for me. So I moved back home to Derby and really wanted to create an online business, because that meant I could work from anywhere in the world, you know, that I could fly out somewhere but still be able to work. And in the end, I ended up doing something with a very close friend of mine and starting a health and fitness company, which was something I had always been really passionate about. I've really enjoyed sport and exercise from a young age, and gradually got into really clean eating as I got older. And then, yeah, what happened was, as of course you know, yeah. I really reached the end of my tether with it all. So I was supposed to go on holiday to Thailand with Nicky and five of our other friends.
Yeah.
We'd already paid for this holiday. And perhaps, how long before the flight did I pull out? Probably 10 days
before. Yeah, it was a bit of a shock, because I remember one of our friends said, "Oh, have you heard Pete's not coming to Thailand now?"
Yeah.
And I was like, "Oh, no, I haven't."
Yeah.
But I kind of had a feeling when I heard that it was because of this girl, for some reason.
Yeah.
And at this time, all of us, we used to go out a lot, you know, we used to get drunk a lot, you know, we were like the average kind of young people in England, really. We just used to, you know, have pre-drinks at home, get really drunk before we even headed out.
Yeah.
So that's where we kind of were in our lives and what we were doing on a weekly basis.
Yeah.
So yeah, if you just carry on from that then, bro, about why you felt.
Yeah, so about around 10 days before actually flying out, I told the lads I wasn't going to go. And what that meant was that when they left and I actually took them down to the airport, I knew I had 2 weeks. And I just felt like I'd backed myself into this corner, really. That I just had to make something of these 2 weeks. And I was really rolling off pure desire at this point, like just doing exactly what I felt was right in every single moment. Whether, you know, when I look back at it, I've made a lot of mistakes for sure, but I was just acting so spontaneously for those 2 weeks. And in effect, what ended up happening was that when the guys went away, I, to begin with, just started hitting up, you know, 16 hours a day, perhaps, worth of work. I was barely sleeping. And the to and fro nature with the girl really peaked again. You know, things were looking all right for a moment and we were going to go somewhere together, and then there was just sudden silence again, and it was the straw that broke the camel's back for me. And I decided I needed to just say exactly how I felt, and I ended up writing two very long Facebook messages or emails, I can't remember now which I sent them over actually, but yeah, two very long ones, roughly, you know, sort of like 2,000 words maybe, like it was, you know, it was long. And, just completely head to toe explaining how I felt.
Yeah.
And like I said, I was on a real emotional roller coaster throughout these 2 weeks. And after sending that second email, I just had the most amazing experience of my life, where I sat down to just reflect on it all and everything that had happened. And I was in my room at my parents' house that I'd grown up in. And I hadn't been there much for the past 5 years, because I'd been at university in London and such. Then I'd just moved back to Derby and was there for a few months before moving into my own home. And I was only a week away from moving into my own house when this happened. And I just sat down and tried to reflect on, well, I didn't try to, it just naturally came about that I reflected on what happened.
And the messages
that I'd sent to the girl. And I just began to, you know, to cry about it. And just as the first few tears started coming, suddenly I was sat on the edge of my bed, you know, like this, and just, I was completely alone, like I said, and I just felt the most overwhelming love entering me from completely outside of, you know, completely outside of myself. And it was way more powerful than anything I've ever experienced before. You know, it was the most beautiful experience, and it was just perfect. And it lasted perhaps, you know, only a number of minutes, and I just fell back onto my bed, and again was still crying and just pretty much shaking or trembling, you'd say, I guess, whilst
it was all
experiencing this. And at the end of it, I just sat up, bolt upright, out of my bed, and was like, "Oh my days!" I was like, "God is real, and I have a soulmate." I knew I uttered those words out of my mouth, like they, you know, just automatically, and I knew them to be true.
As soon as you felt that,
the second I had felt that experience, and I had no mental
concepts of God or soulmates.
So to try and understand that was really, really perplexing to me. And this, you know, the lads were only maybe a week into their holiday at this point, so I still had another week to myself. And if I wasn't sleeping much before, I slept even less after this. So, you know, it went very suddenly then that I was getting nearly no sleep at all, because I was just, my mind was trying to catch up with what my heart knew inside.
Yeah.
And that next week was just crazy. It was so turbulent.
It was almost like you're trying to get the logic to catch up with what you felt in your heart, wasn't it really in that point, wasn't it? That's what you were attempting to try and find some explanation for what happened, that experience.
Yeah, exactly that. Yeah. That was now I can reflect back and see that at that point I had a real thirsty, passionate desire to receive God's truth at that point in time. You know, after I'd had that first experience of receiving God's love, I then wanted to know the truth about what it was. And I was looking everywhere, like knowingly or not, basically. And yeah, within a week, I think it was roughly about a week afterwards, I had moved into my own house at this point, like I said, and it was just my first night there. And it could have been my second, but it was either my first or second night there. I'd gone to bed at about 4 a.m, which was, you know, very much the norm for me at the time.
That was the sleeping pattern you were in.
Yeah, that was the sort of sleeping pattern. I'd probably sleep from 4 till 11 or something. And again, I just had another very remarkable experience in that I woke up at 7 a.m. But it was like I'd been woken up. And I wasn't tired. I was completely awake. I had no thoughts enter my mind. I just simply got up, walked downstairs. I was in the house by myself. Just walked downstairs to my lounge, decided to put the TV on, and the very first words were, "And our next guest on the show today says that he's Jesus of Nazareth and that his partner is Mary Magdalene." And it was Eamon Holmes that was talking, the TV presenter, for those of you that aren't in the UK. It's like a Good Morning television show. And
it's called This Morning, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. It's called This Morning. There's clips of that interview on the Divine Truth channel that you can see.
On YouTube,
yeah. And it was a very, very unique experience again for me, because as I was watching it, I almost knew from the very second I first saw Jesus and heard those words that, again, internally I felt very strongly that, yeah, this is true. I was like, "This man's Jesus." And I was like, that's crazy. Like, but I just felt that that was completely true. Mm. And again, because I didn't have a religious background, I never had any beliefs that Jesus was this man that came along 2,000 years ago and freed us all from our sins. And I was never too sure what I thought of any of that stuff, to be honest. So I didn't have a big preconception as to who Jesus was.
Quite a blank slate in that regard.
Yeah, very blank slate. Yeah. So then when I watched the interview and watched, you know, how Jesus, or Alan John Miller this time around, as some will call him, came across, I wasn't like trying to cross-check that with my already predetermined definition of who Jesus was and not what Jesus should be like. I was just simply looking at a man that I was listening to and thought, wow, this man's a really loving guy and seems really honest. And again, inside my heart at that moment, I was sure that this man was Jesus. I didn't even particularly feel I needed any more convincing, which is surprising, but that was how it was. That's the truth.
Yeah. And you're quite thorough, aren't you, as well? You've always been very thorough with things. You've always done a lot of research into things. But in this regard, in this situation, after that experience you had with God on your bed, and then, what was it, a week later you came across Jesus on talking on this morning.
Yeah.
It was just, you knew straight away in your heart, didn't you?
Straight away.
There was no logical processing that you did. No. You know, you weren't resistive because of any pre-held beliefs you had about God or Jesus or anything like that. You were just dead open, weren't you, the whole time to what was being shown.
Yeah.
That's a real key thing, really, isn't it?
Yeah, it made all the difference in terms of me being able to accept what I felt and not feel like I was going crazy about anything. It just it wasn't too difficult for me to accept.
And it was almost like after you saw that on the TV, what happened before with God all made sense.
Oh, totally.
Yeah. It just all clicked.
Total sense. Things started to click very quickly. And when they clicked even more so was then when I watched just the very first Divine Truth video, which is overviews of the universe. And there's four parts to it. And I'm only talking about watching the first part. But as I was listening to it, it was, it was as if most of this I had already heard before, perhaps. You know, it just felt so...
Right,
and made total sense to me in every single regard. So it was just unquestionable for me. There was never a process of happening to go through like a big internal battle of like, oh, is this guy Jesus? Is he not like
and then reading the Bible
and all the Bible and trying to cross reference this with another thing and come to some logical determination about it. It was simply emotional from the start for me, and the only thing that the first sort of feelings that I did have a little bit were, oh man, I was like I know that Jesus is back on earth. I was like, I know God is real, which I didn't know before.
Yeah.
I was like, and like this obviously that's very
very big
knowledge, really important stuff that you want to share with your close friends and family and stuff. But I thought, I can't share this. This was how I felt at the time.
Yeah.
It was, a flawed belief, but I felt like, oh, I can't share this. Everyone's going to think I'm crazy, I'm just going to have to crack on with this by myself sort of thing. And and within a few days was then the time that obviously you know very well, where myself and Nicky and one other friend went for a meal. And you'd obviously...
Yeah. I was going through my own, probably as soon as I came back from this holiday to Thailand and I went back to work, I was in this place where all of a sudden I just wanted to know about God. Like, I never had any beliefs again like Pete. We've grown up together, we had very similar beliefs anyway from when we were children based on our family. Both of our families were quite close. So I was going through my own process of just really wanted to know in my heart who God was and if God even existed, because I didn't even know if God existed at the time. And as I said, I won't go into all the detail about what happened with me, but I got to this point where I was getting all of these like very obvious physical signs that were leading me to just the name Jesus. And I didn't know what it meant. I was thinking maybe... I'm being shown that Christianity, the truth of the universe and of God, and then also I was being led to like Islam as well, because they believe in Jesus as a prophet and whatnot. And I had quite a few Muslim friends as well who I used to work with, and I spoke to a lot of people at work. I spoke with the Muslims about their beliefs about Jesus, and then I spoke to the Christians and their beliefs. So I had a good knowledge about what they felt Jesus did and who he was, and also about God as well, and I've got their views on God. So I was just getting all this stuff for Jesus. I couldn't make sense of it. I didn't know what it was.
And I didn't really know that he was going through that either. We hadn't shared these things at this point.
Yeah. There was a week where we didn't talk.
Yeah.
Because I was working, you were busy and stuff. Just that's what happens in life. But I was going through all this mayhem myself. and I was literally freaking out on my own, like in my bed at night. I just couldn't sleep. And I was just thinking, I just don't know. I was just so confused. And I just said out loud in my bed, I said, God, if you exist, please, I just want to know the truth, your truth. I want to know if you're real. And just I want to know the truth of you, basically. And then, as I said, I met with Pete Didn't know what was happening with one another. We sat down, and as soon as we sat down, I just said to Pete, before we even ordered the food or anything, I was like, bro, I need to speak to you about stuff that's been happening with me. And as soon as I said that, Pete started smiling. Mm. You started smiling, didn't you? And you were like, I think I know what you're going to say. Mm. And I was like, right, okay. And it was dead weird. It was it felt like we were both on the right thing. Mm. We were both coming to this big knowledge of something.
Yeah, this big mutual understanding that was coming.
Yeah, and I then proceeded to tell Pete about all the stuff that happened to me at work and this feeling I had within me to want to know who God is. And told him about all of that. And then Pete said, well, bro, I've got something to tell you then. And then that's when you told me about all the stuff that you've just said to everyone listening at home. And based on my own, the stuff that's happening with me, and I was getting all of these signs that were leading me to Jesus, my heart was open at that time as well to hear what Pete had to say about Jesus, AJ, and I was open to at least like listening to it and like investigating it for myself and seeing what this man had to say. Because I know a lot of people, they hear, oh, he's Jesus, and then that's it. Like for 99% of people, they just like switch off. They say, oh, you know, he's crazy or whatever, or delusional, or he's you know, or even he's just being very manipulative and he's lying to trick people to, you know, for his own benefit. And yeah, I mean, I had none of those feelings. I was just like, right, you know, it seems like this is the culmination of all of my experiences now has led me to this point. And yeah, we both watched a couple of the YouTube videos, didn't we, together?
Yeah, the overviews.
And we were both watching them and we were like, wow, this all feels so true to me. Well, everything he's saying just feels so true.
Yeah.
And the one thing that led me to continue watching the videos was that I didn't know, I wasn't certain, as Pete was at the time, that AJ was Jesus. I didn't have that 100% belief, but I was feeling very strongly that it probably was true. And as we watched more and more, we'll get to this point where we're like, right, we've got to start putting this into practice if we're ever going to know the truth. Like, we've got to at least try what he's saying, and then through our own personal experiences, we'll be able to determine and ascertain the truth. So that's what we ended up doing, didn't we, really, together. And then at this point, I moved in with Pete's house in Derby. I moved back to London, back from London to Derby as well. And we were living together. And like almost every day, we were watching videos and talking about what we've learned and any experiences we've had. And this grew for probably how long? Probably about maybe from July 2013 to like probably February 2014.
Yeah, I was going to say maybe
six, seven, eight months. We were really
consuming a lot of the knowledge at that point, you know, like watching a lot of videos and really engrossed in it. And
putting things into practice and stuff. And I mean, it was November, December 2013 was when I first had my experience with God. Yeah. So I had the experience that Pete had. But for me, it was where I was asking, I just got to a point where I heard so much, it felt so true to me, everything that was being said, when I was just like, right, I need to ask God this now. I have to know. Like, my heart has to know. It was almost a feeling like, I'll die if I don't know if this is true or not.
Yeah.
Like, it was really that intense for me. And I was, I just asked God one night, I was alone in my bedroom, and I just said, God, you know, if you exist, if there is love that you'd like to give me, and if AJ is actually Jesus and Mary is actually Mary Magdalene, then please would I be able to receive the gift of your love. And even before I finished that prayer, I instantly started feeling God's love coming into my soul. And it was just like, it's just, you cannot mistake the experience, basically.
No.
Can you?
No.
You know when you've felt God's love, or you receive some truth from God, because it's its own unique substance, and because of how overwhelming it is and how like fulfilling it is. You know as a fact that you just connected with God, don't
you? There's zero doubt there about it. You're not going to have an experience, or you may have an experience, but it won't be an experience with God where if you come out wondering, oh, was that maybe God? It wasn't in that scenario. When you do feel God's love enter your soul for the first time, you will know it, as well as you know that gravity exists. It's
undeniable.
It's undeniable, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, one thing that I would say as well with that is when, let's say, for example, you go out on a windy day, and you can feel the wind on your face and on your clothes. You can see the effects the wind is having on the trees and, you know, swaying the branches and the leaves and stuff. And obviously, with God, you can't see God. Yeah. So it's like the wind. You can't see the wind. But for me, it is undeniable that you know it exists, even though you can't see it, because you felt it.
Yeah.
Like the wind, when you're feeling that in your face, you know it exists because you felt it. And that's exactly how it is with God, but it's more real than even the wind hitting your face on a day. That's how real it is, isn't it?
Yeah. And if you use the wind example again, it's like before having felt God, it would be like having lived in a glass house your whole life. And, you know, you can perhaps look at the wind, and that would be, you know, in reference to like looking at, well, not looking at the wind, but looking at the effects of it.
Yeah.
You know, that would be like looking at other religions now, thinking, oh yeah, maybe there's a God, maybe there's not. You know, I can see there's some things happening, you know. But that moment that you first step outside and you feel wind, you know it exists. It's
straight
a certainty.
Yeah.
You know, you felt it against your own skin. And it's the same thing with God, but like Nicky said, even more
undeniable.
Yeah.
So going on from that, what we both kind of decided was in February 2014, we saw that Jesus and Mary were actually setting up an assistance group in Australia.
Yeah.
And we both sat down one night, and I just said to you, didn't I, bro?
Yeah.
I just said, bro, like, have you seen they've got this assistance group cracking off it? Like, this summer in 2014, the summer of 2014. And I just said, like, should we go? And I just, like, mentioned it. And we both went dead quiet for a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
And then we looked at each other and we're like, screw it, let's go.
Let's just go.
Like, even if it's on the other side of the world, like, we have to know more about this. We have to meet the guys for ourselves.
Yeah. Like, because obviously being in England, we were geographically positioned as far away from Australia as we possibly could be. You know, it was it's a real journey and stuff. But
yeah, so
put us off at all.
It didn't put us off because we were just so wanting it, like wanting to know more, wanting to meet the guys. And it would have been such an amazing experience because we were both certain that AJ is Jesus at that point anyway.
Mm.
And going over there, it was almost like it was just a great experience. We'll be able to meet Jesus, meet Mary, meet all the other people there that we've seen on the presentations beforehand and stuff. So that was really cool. So we just booked it all, didn't we? And we went over.
Yeah.
And whatnot. And that was like probably up until this point, I'd say it's the best decision I've ever made in my life.
Yeah.
For us to just go there and experience it all for the 10 days. The amount of knowledge we actually received there was unbelievable. And also we got the priceless experience of actually meeting Jesus and Mary, talking with them, sharing ourselves with them. They shared themselves with us. And we got a lot of awesome feedback from them. And it was a lot about woman stuff actually, wasn't it, which is what we were talking about with you and your experience.
Absolutely, yeah. And that was also the first time both of us even became anywhere aware of some of our mother related and women related injuries. You know, we were both had blind eye to that at the time.
A big blind spot
We were without going diving hugely into our mother related injuries, because that would be another video in itself.
Yeah.
You know, it's a long topic. We both pretty much basically had mothers that, you know, we were their little boys, you know, and they, you know, they put a lot into us, if you like, and
to us, our mothers were like best mums.
Yeah,
like we felt our mums were the best mums that were ever on earth.
Yeah, Yeah, we thought they were absolutely, you know, fantastic and flawless, if you like, you know.
Yeah.
And I guess that really... was challenged during that trip. Yeah, more than anything else, that was the main thing, I guess, the biggest new information we received, certainly I felt.
And that was the main attraction, wasn't it, at that group? There were a lot of women there, and we were essentially like, we were men at the time who used to pander to women's anger, and we just did whatever they wanted to do and stuff. So it was a perfect attraction for us in that regard, wasn't it,
with the group? Was.
There was a lot of spirits.
A lot of angry women's spirits.
A lot of angry women's spirits there, you know, I don't think they attacked you as much as me, but because I was getting headaches in the first, you know, couple of days, and I was finding it was really heavy, like the atmosphere there, and it was quite tough. But yeah, that's when I guess you mentioned what happened with you, didn't you, to Jesus and Mary, and about this girl.
So this sort of, I guess, leads us in nicely to where we're going with this video today, with suppressing emotion and things. So for me, when we were there in the August assistance group, it was one of the conversations we sat down at the dinner table with Jesus and Mary. And during one of those conversations, Jesus, I remember him asking me a few very gentle questions about my feelings towards this girl that I, by this point in time, had very quickly assumed must be my soulmate. Because I received that truth from God in my first experience that I had a soulmate, and all of this experience had come from me pursuing this girl, if you like. That was the main factor that really, I guess, got me in that emotional place. I just naturally made the assumption that it must be her, and I obviously had a lot of investment, you know, in that being true. So I never really considered elsewhere, you know, that it could be someone else. Because A, I wanted it to be true, and B, it was the only thing that made sense to me at the time.
Yeah.
And I remember Jesus asking, you know, a couple of questions, you know, that in hindsight I can see were probably in trying to open me up a bit more to the fact that perhaps it could be someone else. But I was still pretty shut down to that, and as we've talked about recently, like, that was kind of the one area for me in the past with Divine Truth.
The big area
that I couldn't, I guess I was very resistive to hearing new truth on, because I just didn't want to hear anything outside of that. You know, I had too much investment in it from an emotional perspective. Yeah. And
that was like even the case when we used to speak.
Yeah, for
like,
you, that was the one area.
I was like,
I couldn't talk
to Pete about that area. Yeah. I just couldn't. I was like, you just won't want to hear anything to do with this girl, or any suggestion that this girl may not be your soulmate and stuff. So, yeah, I mean, I guess it was almost Jesus like opening you up to just considering whether there could be some kind of addiction, you know, some addiction at play between you both.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
and during the very moments of that conversation, it did bring up some stuff, but of course I've then shut that down again quite quickly over the next few weeks even, and put that again back to the back of my mind for a while. And so at this point of time, we've now reached what, sort of, we're in September 2014.
Yeah, so back home,
in Derby, you know. Then I guess the next 6 months were relatively sort of carrying on as normal, in a sense of trying to progress, trying to grow our relationship with God, but I still had this big block towards, in this one area, that I was still dead fixed on this girl being my soulmate.
Mm.
So I was still trying to make progress, well, not just in other areas, I was trying to make progress in this area quite strongly, you know, because I wanted to attract her into my life. But of course, when I was barking up the wrong tree, you know, so I wasn't getting very far with it, basically. Because it wasn't truth from God's perspective, you know.
Yeah.
So then we got to this time where we had the conversation with Jesus and Mary.
Yeah,
on Skype.
So what we did, you sent Jesus and Mary over an email, just letting them know, you know, what you've been working on and hope, you know, asking if they're okay, and I did the same thing and stuff. And of course, Jesus and Mary are extremely busy a lot of the time. They receive a lot of emails from a lot of people. And, you know, it's not like we were expecting a response from them. We just felt that we would like to just tell them a bit more about what we've been experiencing and stuff. And then anyway, one day, It was February 2015, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's right.
Where I was kind of working through a few things, and I just felt, I prayed to God, and I was just like, oh God, I'd love so much to hear from Jesus, like, and Mary, if they have any time, you know, because I know they're busy, just if they would love to, if there's an opportunity that we could have a chat with them on Skype or anything, just to, you know, catch up with them, see how they're getting on, and also see if they have any feedback for us.
Yeah.
So, kind of like a couple of days after that prayer and that real desire I had, lo and behold, we both received an email from Jesus, didn't we? Saying how busy he was, but he's open for a chat with us on Skype.
Yeah.
And we got that all set up, didn't we? And
yeah.
We had a chat for about, what was it, 3.5 hours or something?
Something like that.
And Mary.
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah.
It was a bit in the early hours of the morning, wasn't it? Because of the big time difference again, so.
Yeah, and I guess you spoke a lot with Jesus, didn't you, and about this stuff with the girl, didn't mm-hmm. you? And
yeah, so this is where Jesus and Mary, but mostly Jesus, I guess, shared with me this the fact. Again, it was kind of further asking questions to try and open me up to the idea that maybe this girl was not my soulmate. And he asked a few questions, you know, like. I remember him asking you, like, you know, do you feel she has the same sort of personality as me?
And I wasn't sure.
You know, you weren't sure, and such and such. And also that, you know, that we did like doing a lot of the same type of things. But again, that's another area where perhaps we were misviewing, you know, what were aspects of the personality and stuff, and which were just desires that were a side of that or, you know, other things. So we weren't viewing the other half correctly at this point.
No,
at all,
not at all.
And still won't be there just yet now either. But Jesus basically asked some questions that at this point I, you know, clearly did receive as quite clear, you know, what the intention was to open me up to the fact that this girl was perhaps and most probably not my soulmate. And for me, that was obviously very hard to hear. It was, I can't think of anything that would have been harder to hear for me, because I had, you know, probably 7 years worth, you know, certainly five years of really intense emotion invested into this thing by this point.
And a lot of time you invested in talking with her over Skype and whatnot, didn't you? There was a lot in there and going on holidays.
I mean, by this point in time, we hadn't even really been much in contact for the past 18 months, but I still believe she was my soulmate from, you know, from the last sort of experiences that we'd had, which all ended around that time I first felt God. And I've been quite invested in it being her right up until that point. And my heart just hit the floor. I remember Mary used those words near enough. She was like,
said, oh, I feel we've rocked your world a bit.
Yeah, I know we're rocking your world. Yeah, I feel your heart's just dropped, sort of.
Yeah, and I remember, because I knew this about Pete very well anyway at this point.
Yeah, you know,
I knew this is the one thing that really, really get Pete's heart.
Yeah.
And I was sat there and I literally felt your heart just drop, like your heart just died almost in that moment, and I just felt like this is going to be a big thing now for Pete, like what he chooses to do from this point on, really, with the information that has been, the feedback that was gifted to us by Jesus and Mary. So because one thing Jesus mentioned was that you're kind of looking at this girl through rose-tinted glasses, didn't he?
Yeah.
Like, what did he mean by that? If you just share that with, like, the other people.
He just meant that I was forever making excuses for her, you know, seeing the good things and being totally obscure to all the negative things and, you know, the
and
way she was using me and all the unloving behaviour that was going on. But I would just completely pacify that as something else and, you know, just not see it for what it was. I just was not seeing the picture clearly at all. And in hindsight, I can very much see that now, but that's taking some time. And from that conversation onwards, basically, I just initially just had, like Nicky said, my heart just hit the floor. I didn't know what to do.
Yeah.
And I reverted back to the only thing I knew, I guess, at that point, which was just escaping my emotion, really, and just
trying to avoid them.
Just trying to avoid them, yeah.
because this was just so, what's the word for it? Like, just so overwhelming and kind of just felt destructive and end of the world, you know, at the time.
Because you put everything into this girl, didn't you? So obviously, you know, potentially hearing something like that, you can imagine the feelings that would trigger within you if you, you know, you may feel that about the person you're really investing in being soulmate. So, yeah.
So you know, it was really hard news to hear. And going back to the things I then chose to do was basically I'd been, like I said, gone to university and been a, you know, like Nicky described earlier, big drinker, you know, for those years, pre-drinks, go out, get smashed. Did that for maybe like 3-4 years and whatnot. And then at the end of the university, I kind of stopped drinking alcohol and started smoking weed. So switched from one thing to another. And I'd still like been smoking weed for quite some time, you know, still as all that first year and so of Divine Truth, you know, it was still a regular habit of mine because I was still just consuming knowledge and wasn't getting around to facing many of my emotions at the time, you know, so I'd just sit there stoned a lot of the time listening to things and just trying to absorb information and whatnot. And at this point in time, during the conversation that we had with Jesus and Mary, I'd stopped it all for about somewhere between 3 and 4 months.
You didn't smoke.
It was about 3 or 4 months before that conversation. So it wasn't like I'd been sober for 2-3 years, but I'd been so completely sober for a little while. And that just didn't last at all, basically. Within the next, you know, within the next few days or so, I was back in the
habit of it.
In the habit of it.
The addiction.
Yeah, in the addiction. And just choosing to smoke to avoid with one of my close friends who lived with us. And I was just partaking in that. And that then went on for pretty much
almost a straight year,
probably about 10 months, you know, in total.
And it was one of those things, wasn't it? Because, like, I knew that as soon as Pete received that feedback from Jesus and Mary, Pete was going to have to make a choice there and then of whether he was going to get stuck into the emotions of it all and let himself feel all the sadness around the whole situation, or if he was going to try and avoid it and go to weed, basically. Mm. And I was just there, and I was obviously hoping that you would have gone into the emotions and stuff, but you actually ended up going the other way, didn't you? And it was dead weird because me, Pete, and our friend, we were living together, the three of us living in the house, and you know, when I saw Pete was going to the smoking and stuff, I saw that your desire for Divine Truth dropped then, didn't it, for a while because of what the feedback we heard and that you received.
I had no desire at all to get into that grief or to try and process it because it just felt too painful, I guess, to me. It wasn't that I questioned any of what I'd learned. You know, every day I still always had a very clear sense, particularly, you know, in the mornings and through the first half of my day whilst I'd be working and things. I knew exactly what I was doing intellectually. You know, I thought, you know, I'd often have the thoughts of, what am I doing here? You know I need to get into this stuff emotionally. I'm like, but you know, what would come out of me was, no, bugger that. That's not what I want to do. Screw it. I'm going to smoke. And so on and so on.
Yeah, because almost what you're doing in the first part of the day, you're kind of trying to intellectualize with it all.
Yeah.
And then when you realize the, almost like the intellect in that part of the day couldn't succumb the emotions.
Yeah.
That's when then you went to the weed, the marijuana, the substance, to engage in the addiction, to suppress all those feelings back down, wasn't it? That's exactly what was happening.
Which prevented them, obviously, from bubbling up at all, you know, in the evenings. And this is where, I guess, if there's anything really important that I want to share in this video, it's this point here about how powerful and stagnant, how powerful suppressing emotion can be, in a sense of, if you know, once you choose to suppress it, you just allow all this all this interaction with spirits that are then going to choose to help, you know, manipulate and choose to smoke and do things that are going to basically keep you away from progressing and developing your relationship with God, and are just going to engage routinely physical addictions and things and completely subside your emotions. And that's exactly what happened to me. And it's, I just want to say that there's no point, there's no benefit to doing it, you know. It's
sort of a waste of time.
It's a waste of time, and it causes more pain ultimately, you know, because you're just avoiding and avoiding and avoiding it. So then you also, when you do finally get to facing it, come to have the extra emotion of, look at all this time I've wasted, you know, trying to avoid this.
Yeah, and what happened whilst you're in that situation with the smoking and the habit of that addiction on a daily basis? Like, I really, like, we both knew what was happening, because I was living there and I was like, I can't, you know, I'm not going to force Divine Truth onto Pete, because he knows what he's doing anyway.
Yeah.
And we had that brief, chat, and we were like, yeah, like, we know what's happening and stuff. And I was like, kind of, it was dead weird, like, we're living together, but we just didn't talk with each other much, because you just didn't want to, like, face that stuff, did you, at all, really?
No.
And I was in a place where I've got to respect my own cousin's will and stuff, and whilst also working on my own stuff. And that also brought up a lot of my own issues that I had, that I received from my dad anyway, that the situation with Pete triggered for me. And I ended up getting to a point after about 9 months of this cycle where I just moved down to London, and that's where then I met Perry.
Yeah.
The third musketeer is not here. he's not with us today, but I ended up moving down to London, and me and Perry started working on projects and stuff, and we knew that, like, I knew as well that there'll be a point where Pete would realise what he's doing and he would want to stop it. Like, I knew that would happen. I just didn't know when. And, you know, we always, like, I knew that when Pete would open up again, then I'd love to help as much as I could myself, you know. Not saying that I know tons, but, you know, just offer as much assist as I could to Pete as he's given to me and how we gave to each other before this all happened. So that kind of happened quite recently, actually, didn't it?
Yeah, when it happened earlier this year.
So when did things start changing for you then, bro?
They started to change towards the very back end of 2015, was when I could feel a shift inside of me that suddenly there was a growing desire. Suddenly, obviously it started small, but a growing desire that I did want to tackle this stuff, and that I didn't want to engage, you know, a great deal more time just smoking and avoiding myself. And, you know, it wasn't like I wasn't just sitting smoking weed all day. I was just distracting myself with lots of things. I was working very hard, you know, trying to earn more money and things, and just not focusing on my emotions is what I mean. And then I would be smoking weed in the evenings. And this shift occurred around the end of the year, where I wanted to get to some of these emotions, but then this was when even more spirit influence came in, I guess, and I could really feel the nature of them a bit more, that I was then being manipulated, you know, because I'd start the day and think, no, I'm not going to smoke today, sort of thing. But then certain manipulations and things would happen to me as we got towards the evening time that would always bring, you know, knock me back there. And
you felt the push of these spirits, didn't you, wanting me to do it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, whereas beforehand, they probably didn't have to push me too hard, because
you,
I was choosing that myself. That was what I wanted to do. And yeah, I guess around, when was it that I went to Tenerife? February, was it?
Yeah, because that's when me and Perry went to Lanzarote.
Yeah. Okay. So I had a book. I had a little trip booked to Tenerife for 4 or 5 days with a couple of friends, and we went out there, and basically, I actually was still smoking weed whilst we were out there in the evenings. We, you know, very quickly, 3 out of 4 of us that went on the holiday smoked weed at the time, and we very quickly attracted a couple of blokes that were selling us some, and, you know, so we picked that up. And and in the evenings we'd have a smoke. But we were pretty active throughout the day, and we weren't smoking throughout the day, and we were doing lots of other things. And I was certainly allowing myself time to get into some emotions by this point. You know, I wasn't
you're having more time for yourself.
Yeah, I was having a lot more time for myself. So there was this growing snowballing desire to open back up. And it was on the flight home where, you know, as everybody who's ever flown knows, that there's very little to do on a flight, you know. And this was a 4.5 hour flight back from Tenerife, so it wasn't like it was long haul and you had the nice little TV in front of your screen or nothing, you know. It was just you know,
a standard economy class cabin.
And I just, and we'd also, because we'd all booked our seats separately, I wasn't sat next to my friends, I was by myself, sat with two people I didn't know. And I just thought to myself, I'm going to use this time to like write a letter to Jesus and Mary. Not even that I was particularly intending on sending it at the time, just to go through the process of writing it, see what it brought up,
yeah.
And to sort of, you know, say what I've been doing and what a waste of time it is and things like that. Mm. And writing that letter, just really, really helped me more than I can probably explain right now, because it just, I think the, if I remember rightly, some of the lines that really got me was when I was writing on my phone, and, you know, I was like, I'm, you know, it's so weird, I know all this truth, you know, I know very clearly about, you know, that God is real, and that the divine truth is God's truth, and that you yourself, aka Jesus and Mary, are here back on earth teaching it. I was like, I know all this still. I've never doubted that, even throughout this whole, past 10 months. I was like, but I'm just not choosing to act on it. And I was like, it's so weird and so stupid. And you can hear it as I'm saying it now, that I just started to sink in. It was like the penny dropped again.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, what am I doing? I need to knock this on the head. Like, I need to sort myself out and just straighten up again.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and that happened, basically. You know, I came back from that holiday and probably
sent me a message as well.
I got in touch with Nick within the first week of getting back, I think. And
and that was quite interesting from my point of view, because me and Perry, as you may have seen from a previous video, the one we did about negative spirit influence and will, myself and Perry were in Lanzarote for 2 weeks, and we were working on a lot of our own father injuries and whatnot. And towards the end of that trip, as I was working through stuff, I was sat in one of the cafes on my own, and I was just some more emotion just came up for me as I was in the cafe on my own. And then I was thinking, it just came to me, I was like, I think something's happened with Pete. I think Pete's going to get back in touch with me, actually. And this is when, you know, I was in London by this point for 6 months,
yeah,
wasn't I? So we didn't really speak for 6 months,
yeah.
And then lo and behold, like the next day, that's when I received a message from you,
yeah,
saying you've had a few experiences and you like to catch up and stuff. And
yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And it wasn't even that I had necessarily gone through all the grief of, and I still haven't gone through it all, of the grief relating to this girl and the issues with the, with the soulmate scenario. But what it is that I have processed through. I no longer have any desire to see her as my soulmate. That's the biggest difference that slowly but surely I got through. In that I now feel far more open to the fact that anybody could be my soulmate, and feel pretty clear that the rose-tinted glasses are now off, and I actually can now look back and see this interaction with that girl, and for what it was. And I still have grief to process about it, more to do with the way I've misunderstood it, in terms of the experiences with God and me, the way I just naturally assumed that it must be her, you know. Still feels a little to me like I still have these feelings in me as if like I've been tricked a little bit, you know, by somebody, you know, because there are a lot of, again, without going into all the small details, but I had lots of very unique, very bizarre experiences with this girl at times, a lot that she didn't even know about, that always just felt like it was somebody sort of showing me like, oh, this is extremely special, extremely important, mm-hmm. You know. So when I learnt that truth about having a soulmate, for it to not be her, you know, I've still got feelings to go through in that regard. But the rose-tinted glasses and actually wanting her to be my soulmate are now completely off, and that's then enabled this me to now be totally open again, even more so than when I first discovered Divine Truth, because then I still had this big desire to see her as my soulmate. Whereas now there's just a complete blank slate, and it feels great. You know, I'm the most excited I've been in.
And it was almost like your initial driving force with Divine Truth was for this girl, wasn't it? To bring this girl into your life so you could have this relationship together.
Yeah.
And now, because that was such a big, you know, sticking point for you, which led you to avoid Divine Truth for almost a year, you've now gone through that, and now you're in a place where, like, you just love Divine Truth again, like, all the passions come back for actually wanting to act on things with me and Perry and, you know, all of that.
So. Yeah, that's it. And it's, I never lost the love for Divine Truth as a, you know, as a set of teachings and a set of laws. What I had never, you know, I still always had a real tender love for it. It was just that it was buried under all this, you know, sadness that I didn't want to feel. So the thing I lost was the desire to act on what I knew about Divine Truth. You know, it was never, I never felt any lack of love for Jesus, Mary, or the things they taught me. That was
always there.
That was a foundation as strong as you can, as strong as you can have. You know, they didn't get rocked at all. It was just my own personal desire
to avoid,
yeah. So, and or you could say my own personal desire to grow just, you know, fell through the floor, and I just didn't want anything. I just didn't want to put myself out there to feel that pain and to go through those emotions. And if there's anything that, if any of you guys watching this at all can relate to any of this, particularly if, you know, if there's a person that you feel really locked into about being your soulmate, my advice to you would be to really try to allow yourself to open up to just the possibility that they might not be. You know, you don't have to go and tell yourself they are absolutely not, because to be honest, that's probably no good either. You know, you want to just try and be as open and
as neutral,
as humble
as possible.
Because then you actually allow God and your guides and everybody to help you and show you things. Whereas when you're in a position
fixed,
like what I was,
when you're fixed,
and when you're fixed, what you actually allow is just a lot of spirit manipulation. You know? So I'd get things occur to me all the time whereby I would, you know, I'd process through a little bit of emotion or a decent bit of emotion on one particular occasion, I remember.
And then she would message you.
And then instantly she would message me. And for those of you who do know quite a bit about the soulmate relationship and how that works.
A lot of people think like this as well.
Yeah, you know, a lot of people naturally think. Because they've made some progress and then they immediately, or they've processed through an emotion and then they immediately hear from the other person, they think that that's like a reaffirmation of the fact that they must be soulmates, when in actual fact that's not, certainly not always the case and often not the case. So with me, what was happening in hindsight was that I made a little bit of progress and went through some emotions.
And that was true.
But then rather than it being due to the fact that this girl was my soulmate
and wants to progress
higher, which was the story I was telling myself, the reality of the situation was that spirits were then choosing to probably manipulate her to send me a message to
bring me back down
and, you know, not progress any further and not get any more into the emotion of it. Or simply that she also was sensitive to the fact that I was no longer perhaps going to feed quite as nice emotions over to her and feed so many addictions, even from the other side of the world.
And
her sensitivity to that would be part of the reason why the spirits can hook in and also encourage to send that message. So, you know, I just want to sort of encourage people not to let themselves be lured into that false trap, if you like, of believing that every time you go through an emotion that you then hearing from this person, particularly if there's someone that you have invested interest in being your soulmate, means that it must be them. It doesn't. That, you know, you're only going to know that once you've been through the, you know, all the blocks you have yourself towards your soulmate, whether that's the opposite gender or the same gender as you, you know.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and that's a big key, isn't it? It's a case of, I feel a lot of people when they come across Divine Truth, you know, obviously the soulmate area is such a big area, because as Jesus says, the soulmate relationship is the second most important relationship that any of us are ever going to have.
Yeah.
And the only relationship that's more important than that relationship is our personal relationship with God. So, you know, it is a big thing just to be aware of. And as Pete said, the key is working through your own addictions and your intergender, you know, feelings that you have within yourself that you need to work through in order to actually accurately determine who your soulmate really is. So that's just a huge area. And I know one thing I'd like to mention is just about a few posts that happened on the forum that I created with regards to the soulmate relationship. Now, when the forum went live towards the end of August 2015, a couple of people went on there and started creating threads in the soulmate section of the forum, which is totally awesome. It's cool. It's a huge area. And I could see that people are falling in this same trap that I've fell in the past myself. And also, as you've heard, Pete fell in quite a big way in his experience. And I could see that people are already very fixated on a specific person being their soulmate. And, you know, they were relying a lot on these metaphysical or physical signs of these reaffirmations that when, you know, that happened, they were like, oh, they've got to be my soulmate. You know, there's no other explanation.
Yeah.
And very fixated. And, you know, when I was reading through these threads on the forum, I could feel like there was a lot of demand coming from these people when they were writing this to this person who they felt their soulmate was. There was a lot of demand coming. And, you know, there was a lot of neediness coming out of these people. And I could see that not one person who was writing these threads had actually processed through enough of their own addictions with the other gender or the same gender, whatever their attraction is, to actually accurately analyse their soulmate. And, you know, once I saw this, and bearing in mind that I've seen what happened with Pete and I knew all of Pete's situation, I just was like, no, I've got to say something here, because I don't want people going down the same route that I've gone down and what Pete's gone down in the past. So that's what happened. And I mean, you know, it's just a really important thing to bear in mind, really.
Mm.
And so I guess the two major lessons from this video are the soulmate.
Yeah.
Issue, isn't it?
Yeah, to not, you know, just to not be so invested in any one person being your soulmate. You know, try to be as humble as you can, to be as open as you possibly can to the fact that it could be anyone, and just allow yourself to be really sincere about that, because that then allows all the help and for the law of attraction to really, you know, bring about events that are going to help you grow closer and actually get to the right emotions that do truly block you from your soulmate. So you've got a more sincere chance of actually getting somewhere. Whereas when you were doing what I was doing and being fixed on, you know, the idea of it being one person, instead of allowing, you know, help from your guides and God, so if you start to allow manipulation from spirits to mislead you, and you'll still attract events, you know, for sure.
They'll lead you down the wrong route.
But they'll be leading you down the wrong route. You know, these events will make you think that, you know, they'll probably make you firmer in your belief or your misguided belief about what or who your soulmate may be. So that's certainly the
one key area.
Yeah.
One key lesson in this.
Yeah,
show.
One of the biggest lessons, just be as open and as humble as you possibly can. Really, until you receive the truth from God, or you know it the same way, like the wind example we used earlier. Until, you know, you've got to go through a lot of emotion before you're really truly going to know who your soulmate is.
Don't
jump the gun on it, because it will just slow down your progress.
Yeah, and I guess the second lesson is about suppressing emotions and going to physical addictions to suppress those emotions, and bearing in mind all that time that is lost in that process.
Yeah, because it's not only the pain of you know, for me again, using my example, it's not just avoiding the grief, you know. you've also got that pain of the time wasted when you get to the end of it. So try to just choose to be as humble as you can in the moment, and if you, you know, if you can, go straight into it whenever you receive something or some news,
personal truth,
some feedback or whatever it is, some truth that you know, rocks the boat, so to speak, and, you know, really gets your emotions flowing. Try and just let them flow and, you know, learn from the mistakes, you know, that others like myself have made. And yeah, don't waste that time like I did, because suppressing your emotions really is a you know, it has a powerful spillover effect to your ability to progress. It's not like you can just, people often perhaps mistakenly think that you can suppress this one emotion, but I'll focus and I'll grow on it, all the other areas. And that's just not the case. You know, once you suppress one emotion, you suppress all the others by nature. You know, it's part of how the soul works. You can't just suppress in isolation, not that that would be a good thing to do anyway, but it dampens your whole experience, and it also dampens the amount of joy that you can feel.
Yeah, and then also that's one of the things, isn't it? It's a case of realizing that when you do something like that, like, you just completely shut off to all the truth, aren't you, in that space? Completely shut off to all the truth. And also it's about acknowledging that the issue that's right in front of you is the next biggest issue,
yes,
in your life that God would like you to work through.
Yeah,
because, you know, God only brings events into our lives that we're ready to handle at that specific moment in time.
Yeah.
So whatever that emotion is, if that comes into your awareness there and then, it's like the next part of what you need to work through. And that's how, and then, you know, once you start getting into that pattern of it, you start seeing it as all this progress towards God. You start seeing it as this ladder that you're slowly climbing up towards God. And I guess that is the way to actually progress. So I guess just to sum up as well, like the whole video, and leave the viewers with a final thought, is just don't waste your time, guys. Like, we're on Earth now, it's such an important, crucial time in the Earth's history. We've all got an equal opportunity to create a lot of positive, loving change on this planet while we're here. And, you know, something I've realized, and Pete's recently realized, is you just don't want to get to a point in the future, whether you're old on Earth or once you've passed and you're in the spirit world, you don't want to look back on your life in regret and realize that you could have actually used your will in a real powerful and positive direction that serves God, that serves all your other brothers and sisters, that serves the environment. You know, you just don't want that feeling of regret, you know, when at a point later down the line. So I just say, you know, just experiment with it. Just experiment with everything that Jesus and Mary teach, because without experimenting and getting stuck into it, you're never going to know the truth. Like, you have to experience it to, like, the way you learn truth is through personal experience.
Yeah.
And if you're sat there on the edge of wanting to take action and not taking it, like, it's a real painful place. I've been in that place before for a while, and I wasn't happy. I was getting really fed up and I was depressed, and you just don't want to be stuck in that place, because you can be stuck in that place for a long time. And it's just a case of going, you know what, screw it, I'm going to give it a go while I'm on Earth, while I'm so drawn to these teachings. Yeah. Why wouldn't I not do it? Why would I not give it my best shot? And that's exactly what we've both felt. And from there, we've obviously developed more knowledge, and we've received more truth. We've received more love from God. And now we're at a place where we are acting, we're creating things, we're having a great time doing it. So, yeah, I guess that's the final thing I'd like to leave everyone with. So yeah, I'd like to say thanks, bro, for coming onto the channel and sharing your experience.
Yeah, it's been a pleasure.
I'm sure a lot of people will really benefit from what you shared with everyone, and
I hope so.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure a lot of people will give a lot of people food for thought to examine their lives and see if this is happening at any point in their life. So thanks again, bro. And the next time you probably tune in, we'll probably have Perry back again with me. However, Pete probably will at various points in the future come back on to do a couple more videos, depending on the issues that we all come across in that continued progression. So let's say thanks, guys, for listening and your time, and we'll speak with you soon. Cheers, guys.
Thanks.
See ya.